We basically have very few microorganisms left here. So we have kind of random assemblage of gram-negatives. I try to make the sense out of those, like group them. At this point, we can't really group anything here. So I'm just gonna start with Helicobacter pylori. Another gram-negative rod. Interestingly, it's microaerophilic. So it's a bit challenging to grow it in the culture. Stomach, part of the stomach microbiome. Not always the presence of H. pylori causes peptic ulcer, but it can. So the disease associated is peptic ulcer. So you gotta have a certain concentration of microorganisms. So this microorganism destroys, lyses the mucus, infects epithelium, which results in the inflammation, and damage to the epithelium, since mucus, protective mucus, is gone, and that results in ulcer. Now, how do we know for sure that this microorganism causes peptic ulcer? The answer is stupendously simple. Antibiotic treatment. Basically cures ulcer. You can't cure it completely, it will be gone, it will heal. Does that make sense? Before the discovery of H. pylori, the treatment was to reduce stomach acidity, which didn't work. Okay? Does that make sense? Now, another very interesting microorganism, another gram-negative, is Legionella pneumophila. So this is the causative agent of legionellosis, which is basically atypical pneumonia. Why it is atypical? In most pneumonia cases, the infection happens, so the microorganisms infect the type 1 or type 2 alveolar cells, so just lungs without going into the cell. Legionella is slightly different. It's naturally present in amoeba. The unicellular, well, kind of pathology, the protozoa, right? It's a protozoa, and amoeba live in water. Are you following me? So you have amoeba that lives in water, and you have Legionella. You have Legionella that infects those amoeba, and it's an amoebic parasite. However, when water which contains amoeba gets sprayed, for instance, on humans, does that make sense to you so far? And humans inhale that water, Legionella jumps from amoebae into the alveolar macrophages in the lungs. Okay, that makes sense? An interesting feature of Legionella infection is that legionellosis is non-communicable disease. And there are cases of legionellosis every year, mostly in amusement parks, where there's a lot of water. You know, like these little cooling towers that spray water on people during the hot days. It's a perfect source of amoeba. First cases were very severe and were not treated properly, and people died. But now outbreaks of legionellosis happen at Cedar Point almost every year. Okay, people get treated, they get fine, it's okay. It's not, you know, a big concern. Good? So far? Make sense? Two more gram negatives, the last gram negatives here, gonna be Pseudomonas and Haemophilus influenza. So Pseudomonas aeruginosa. Yet another gram negative. Now this is really, really important clinical pathogen. Okay, not, and the microorganism normally found in the environment, but it is very easily transmitted in the nosocomial setting. So it's a nosocomial opportunistic pathogen. It's a scourge of various hospital wards. It can cause a variety of diseases, from skin infections with absolutely brilliant names such as green nail syndrome or hot tub syndrome. Then it can cause urinary tract infections. It can cause digestive tract infections, but it is most known for pneumonia in cystic fibrosis patients. Now, you're familiar with the disease, cystic fibrosis, correct? So patients with cystic fibrosis are very susceptible to bacterial infections, and for a long time the protocol of treatment included prophylactic antibiotics, which essentially drove all those bacteria that can infect patients with cystic fibrosis towards more and more substantial antibiotic resistance. So right now, we have strains of Pseudomonas aeruginosa that are totally drug resistant. So overall, Pseudomonas is very antibiotic resistant. Okay, like it's a huge, huge problem. Talking about, it can carry resistance to aminoglycosides, cephalosporins, tetracyclines, all together in one microorganism. So treating it is a huge deal. So far, does that make sense? Okay, now, the last microorganism in gram negatives, okay, is going to be Haemophilus influenza. I want to make it very clear, it has nothing to do with the flu. It's not a virus, just the name of it. Okay, Haemophilus means that it loves blood. It can be grown, it's a fastidious bacteria that can be grown only on the agar that contains blood in one or another form. There's not much to tell. It's a respiratory transmitted human pathogen. And it can cause a variety of conditions, from otitis media, middle ear infection, to bacterial pharyngitis. But it is most known for meningitis, along with streptococcus pneumonia and Neisseria meningitidis, along with pneumococcus and meningococcus. Haemophilus influenza is the third most common cause of community acquired meningitis. Thankfully, we have a vaccine. You may have heard about it. It's a Hib vaccine. Okay. One of three vaccines that are mandated by the Ohio Department of Health, whatever. Before kids get to school, they must get all three meningitis vaccines. Okay. So far, makes sense? Okay. Now, These are gram-negatives. Now, we have three species that belong to a slightly different group. They're called Diderm. They have different structure of the bacterial envelope, neither gram-negative nor gram-positive, and they are spirochetes, meaning that shape-wise, they are very thin, long, and spiral. Okay? Now, one important feature of all spirochetes is that they are kind of hard to visualize using conventional bright field microscopy. So instead, for spirochetes, often dark field microscopy is utilized because they're so thin. So what are those? First, and I think kind of a little bit boring one, is Leptospira interrogans. It's the zoonotic infection. Question? Leptospirosis, exactly. This is what your dogs get vaccinated against. And you know why? Not, of course, to protect dogs, but also to protect you. Because it's as Julian mentioned, leptospirosis is a zoonotic disease that can be acquired when you get in contact, especially with dog's urine, okay? And it's generally, it runs as a fever, okay? But if patient is immunocompromised, there's, you know, the infectious dose is way too large, it can result in so-called whale syndrome, which progresses quickly to kidney and liver failure. Okay? Good? Now, exactly, so I just recently pulled my dog vaccination record, of course. He's vaccinated against leptospirosis. Moving on. Another zoonosis that we're going to put here on the board is Borrelia burgdorferi. So this is an organism that is more known. It's a zoonotic organism. Small rodents as well as deer, causative agent of Lyme disease, named after the town or city of Lyme. It's not a person, it's a city of Lyme in Connecticut. Okay, so when you get bitten by a tick, if you develop what's called bullseye rash, looks like this. Okay? If you see this, go to a physician, they will prescribe antibiotics. You will get treated, you will be absolutely fine. You should do it. I know that in some cases, physicians would just prescribe prophylactically, sort of, you got bitten by a tick, just take those antibiotics, would rather be safe than sorry. Okay? Because chronic disease may result in arthritis, myocarditis, and I'm going to put neuropathy, but mostly it's different types of weaknesses due to the neurological damage. Does that make sense so far? Okay, and the most fun of them all, of course, it's Treponema pallidum. It's actually really interesting. Now look, Treponemas are pretty common microorganisms in your mouth. I mean, they're normally present in oral microbiome, but that particular one is the primary pathogen that causes diseases such as syphilis, Bajil, and Yaws. They all basically syphilis. Bajil and Yaws a little bit milder forms, if I may say. Does that make sense? So there are three stages to syphilis. Primary syphilis that manifests, I don't remember the spelling, I think it's C, not K. Chancre. French people know how to name the sickness. It's the French word. So chancres are on the mucosa, the reproductive organs, whether on the glans penis or vaginal mucosa. And then if it's not treated, it can progress to secondary syphilis with rash and fever. Now, bless you. Quite frankly, if you think about like rash and fever, it sounds, right? But if you actually look up the images, it's bad. And one of the things that amazes me in medicine and in infectious disease in particular, when you look at those images, my question, I look through the physician's guide on like treatment of secondary syphilis, and I look at those images, the photographs, and I think, do these people know about such a human invention as a mirror? Like, do you see what's going on down there? And if you do you think that it's gonna just magically get better? Because at this stage it won't. It looks terrifying. Like, you should probably have visited your doctor like 2 months ago. It's just overall, like, if you have that bad of a problem, what do you expect? Like, do you expect it to magically solve itself? So anyway, these two stages are infectious. Now, tertiary syphilis, which is a systemic disease, systemic infection, is non-infectious. Now, first of all, let's address what tertiary syphilis results in. So tertiary syphilis results in lesions in the connective tissue. For instance, the classic trope, stereotype of people who suffered from tertiary syphilis is that they don't have a nose. It's true, because the connective tissue that forms the apex of the nose and some of the part of the bridge, the septal cartilage in the nose and connective tissue that forms ala, they get eaten by a bacteria. So that part, the apex, just goes away. There are those lesions called gommas. I have a photograph of a gomma in notes, but they can be extremely disfiguring and extremely disturbing. Damage to CNS, neurosyphilis, damage to aorta, which results in aortic aneurysms, damage to the kidneys, so systemic disease. Does that make sense? Now, it can be transmitted vertically from mother to child, transplacentally. Usually, syphilis in neonates is associated with rhinorrhea, so runny nose, and malformation. I'm not going to ask these details on the exam. Teeth are malformed. As far as I remember, they, instead of being like this, eventually teeth grow like this. It's called Huntington's teeth. Okay, they kind of bend to the center. Now, very well treatable. Antibiotics take care of it. Transmission route, and I want to make it very, very absolutely clear. We all understand that syphilis, any STD, is a stigma, unfortunately. Syphilis can be transmitted from one reproductive mucosa to another, period. Am I clear? Which means if you shake hands or kiss or hug a person who has syphilis, you're not gonna contract syphilis, okay? And you may ask, why didn't I say that it's sexually transmitted disease? Well, it is, But there were cases when people shared, for instance, a towel and carried microorganisms from one mucosa to another mucosa. Does that make sense? It's like anecdotes, but those anecdotes happened. Any questions? And if you're curious about the origins, it's speculated that syphilis originated in Americas. It's kind of questioned to a certain extent, but I really want to think that it did originate in America because that would be fair. Europeans gave Native Americans smallpox and measles, and they paid us back with syphilis. You know, I think it's fair.